I never wanted this for you. I worked my whole life. I don't apologize to take care of my family. And I refused to be a fool. Dancing on the string, held by all those big shots.
It's not personal. It's strictly business.
I think what comes to mind is the beginning of the film and the office. And I love the dialogue, you know, in that sequence. But there's so much there. There's the development of Al Pacino from being this kid into being the godfather, which is an amazing transformation. I mean, for Francis to know that Pacino was going to be able to make this amazing transition is pretty good.
Okay, that's it. Just like that now. Hold it.
A lot of things happen with luck. This happened with ingenuity in terms of convincing Paramount and Life magazine that you should do a cover. What happened was the Puzo book came out and Paramount paid very little money for it when they discovered that it was becoming an international sensation. I had very good relationships with Paramount, and particularly when it became obvious that Marlon Brando was going to play the Don, I saw that this was going to be sensational. So I talked to Paramount, and I said, well, what would happen if I got Life magazine to guarantee you a cover exclusively? And they said, hey man, if you can do that, fine. So I then went to Life, and I said, what if you could do a cover on The Godfather and be the first way that people really see the image of Marlon Brando as he looks in The Godfather? Would you guarantee a first cover? And they said, we didn't do that for Frank Sinatra. I said, I know that, but would you do it with Marlon Brando and The Godfather? And they said, yes. So I went back to Paramount and I said, I think we have something going. So immediately that put me in the position of being what is called a special photographer.
How's the Italian food in this restaurant?
Good. Try the veal. It's the best in the city.
I'll have it.
The question always comes up, is there a difference between shooting documentary photography and shooting movies as a still photographer on a set? And the answer in my mind is no, because you're looking for the same things. You're looking for the spirit of the event. You're looking for the spirit of the person who you're photographing. You're looking for something special out of what you're doing. And those are the things which motivate you in terms of what you're looking for. I would look at what would tell a story. I would look at how I could really make my actor look good. What angle would work best in terms of my actor or the scene or the situation. And that's what I would start with. After that, I might do other things, but basically I felt I had to get something that was special in some way, or that was an image. I was just going for icon images, and I was hopeful that I would come up with a few. As a still photographer on a set, the important thing is to be very, very quiet at all times. You don't talk, you don't get into conversations, you don't show your ego in any way whatsoever, and you just work on what your chore is to come up with pictures. Being just very quiet and unobtrusive, as unobtrusive as you possibly can be, really makes sense and is very helpful in taking good pictures.
What's the matter, the trigger too tight?
I don't know, my ears.
One of the ways that Gordy shot The Godfather was using shadows, going into shadows. A very good example of that is the picture I took of Brando with the cat. And you look at Brando and you can barely see his eyes in that picture. And Gordy understood what this film was about. And he had to give expression to that so that it wasn't just like any other film. It wasn't like totally well lit and all. I had the greatest respect for him, and he always helped me in terms of with something that had to be lit He would help me if it needed to be lit. I worked with what was called a blimp, which was a metal box which enclosed your camera and kept it quiet so that hardly any sound came out. So instead of the click, 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 which you can't have when you're making a film, there was no noise coming out. But sometimes the conversation might be really, really low and all, and I couldn't shoot during that. And so I would ask the first assistant director, somewhere along the line, can we do something right after? Now, generally, actors don't like that. I mean, they figure, okay, I've done it, baby, and that's it. But we were able to do that at times. So I did do pictures after the take. This was a camera I used with color film. Usually when I worked for Life magazine, I had five cameras that I carried at all times. Because basically, on most stories that I did for Life, you didn't have time to change lenses in any way. You couldn't do it with one camera and expect to do a telephoto shot right after you did a wide angle shot. You just wouldn't have the time. Also, on The Godfather, I of course used many different lenses. This was a 105 millimeter lens I used, which I used on The Godfather. And this was a wide angle lens that I used on The Godfather. Color and black and white have different palettes. Black and white tends to give you contrast, and doing black against white in a picture really makes it stand out. Color is much more subtle, and the contrast does not work as well that way, in the same way that it works in black and white. There's actually a different palette for color and for black and white, and different situations call for color and some for black and white. Black and white is very graphic. I was incredibly impressed with Coppola from the start. I was impressed, first of all, with his writing and just in the way he put this movie together, which is amazing. I mean, to fight so hard against the studio to get what you know is going to make a special movie. Coppola wanted to make a movie, not so much as a shoot 'em up movie, but as a story of an Italian family. And the cast was very much like that. This is a movie which has violence, it has things of that sort, and yet, after every take, the cast was just happy, happy as a lark. Relatives were there very often. The cast kept mooning each other. And it was very, very relaxed. So this is a serious movie. And yet the cast and the whole filming was very relaxed. Working with The Godfather, we were mostly in Staten Island, or else we were at the studio in, I believe, Harlem. And one thing about the studio was it had all these cats running around, all these stray cats. So Francis picked up one of the cats and he said, action, and he threw the cat into Brando's lap to see what Brando would do with it. Nothing was used in the film. I got a good picture, though.
You never told me you knew Johnny Fontaine.
Sure. You want to meet him?
Huh? Oh, sure.
My father helped him with his career.
This was a really good relationship on the movie between Pacino and Diane Keaton. They got along amazingly well. Sonny, of course, is a total hothead in the movie. And finally, he ends up being shot. It's really interesting how they do this. He stands somewhere and they put all these wires coming out of him in terms of different spots on his body. And then when they start making the sound of the bullet, they release these blood clots, which are all over his body. And it looks like he's being shot. These are two variations I shot on The Whisper because there were many takes, so there was opportunity to do things in different ways. And once I got it one way, I wanted to do a different way because it's more interesting.
How did things ever get so far? I don't know.
This is another picture where you can see Gordy Willis's lighting. Normally, most cinematographers would have made Brando's eyes fairly bright in this, but Gordy gets a mood from this, which is much stronger. Here's another image, and Duvall is in it too, and both of them have their eyes dark. This is during a relaxed moment where Brando goes to the piano. This is not in the movie. It's nothing to do with the movie, except the fact that the piano was there. This is Marlon Brando. As he finished filming, he cleaned himself up, and then it was like a small party on the set, but that's the way he really was looking. Marlon Brando, of course, was 47 years old when he played Don Corleone. Dick Smith doing Brando's makeup was certainly something that I asked if I could do, and Brando was really nice about it. And Coppola and Pacino came into the room at the same time and sat there with him. And this was just a moment when they were doing, when Dick Smith was doing makeup, and Marlon gave me a look.
This wasn't enough time, Michael. Wasn't enough time.
We'll get there, Pop. We'll get there.
This is like a key moment in the movie between Pacino and Brando, and it's a good picture because they both are looking serious. They're not looking at the camera or anything like that. They're both involved in their world and where their world was going to.
Go to the Italians and make them think that you're not too happy with our family, and find out what you can.
You have a cast that's unbelievable. You have a script that's unbelievable and makes sense and deals with so many different elements of life. It's a film which gives you a taste of what the mafia is like, or what families in the mafia could be like. It's a film which holds your interest from beginning to end. It's a film which is just an amazing classic and one of the greatest films made. Thank you.